Good morning. I'd like to welcome you to the services of the First Baptist Church of El Paso. This morning I'm going to continue a series of messages about fresh starts. We're going to think together about how God can help us to write an ending to the story of our lives. I think it's a message that should encourage all of us. Thanks for worshiping with us today.
Let's get everyone in this room clapping their hands together. Come on, everyone. We're going to drop all the instruments and we're going to sing this with everything we got. You ready? Here we go, singers. 2, 3, 4.
You lived, you died, you said in 3 days you would rise. You did. You're
sing.
that. You know, the other day my wife was talking to some friends of ours, and they said something. They, you know, she was inviting them to church, and they said, you know what, we don't feel comfortable there because it seems like everyone has their life together. And I guess that could be a compliment, or it could mean we're really good actors, all right? Because I bet you there's people in here that are looking around going, am I the only one with financial problems? Am I the only one with rebellious kids? Am I the only one that wakes up sometimes and has no clue where I'm going in life? And I bet you there's a lot of us looking around thinking that everyone else has a perfect life. And you know, the truth is, there's not one person in this room that has life figured out. Because we're not supposed to, because we're really not of this world. We're not supposed to be. We're children of God, of His kingdom, and we're not supposed to figure this out. There's one person who knows what life's about, and that's God. Not even Satan knows what life's about, because if you read the book, he got destroyed in the end, right? God is the only one that knows. And so right now, Pastor in just a little bit is going to talk about how to start fresh for our destiny, where we're going to end up in life, how to have a fresh start according to God's word. And as Marilyn starts singing this beautiful song called Mighty to Save, which talks about all of us needing compassion and all of us being scared and all of us needing direction in life, we need to know that God's there and He's mighty, mighty to save, mighty to be there for us. As Marilyn sings right now, I want you guys to just kind of close your eyes and think about all those areas in your life that you need to give to God, all those areas that He needs to touch in your life.
Savior, Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Please be seated. We just want to say thank you to Steve for all he's done for this church. What an amazing player he's been, and he's got a heart and a passion, and we're just so blessed to have him at our church. And so thank you so much, Steve. Happy birthday, even if it was yesterday. He's only 65, so he's got another good 2 years left. Let's stand up and let's sing a little bit. He's not 65. I'm just joking. Come thou fount of every blessing.
Come thou fount of every blessing, to my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above.
What's happening today, if we just remember that one simple rule, turn your eyes upon Jesus,
everything in this world will slowly fade away.
You are the light of the world.
So how many of you guys are readers? Anybody a reader out there? Reading some readers? Of course, those of you who are students, you got to read, right? You have to read for class. Well, when you grow up, you get to read for fun. I enjoy reading. I particularly like nonfiction. I read a lot of Malcolm Gladwell. I don't know if you guys keep up with him. He's wrote, I think the first book I read of his was Tipping Point, Blink, Outliers, and then most recently he wrote a book called David and Goliath, where he actually explained that David actually had the advantage over Goliath. Strangely enough, you might want to pick it up. In the area of business and leadership, probably Jim Collins is my favorite author. He and his team wrote the book Built to Last, How the Mighty Have Fallen, and my favorite, Good to Great. If you're going to just do entertainment, John Grisham, that's my guy. You know, he writes great novels. If you don't know about John, he was actually a lawyer in Mississippi, and he began to write on the side, and he wrote a story called It's a Time to Kill. And he tried to get this idea published. It was published, and soon it became a bestseller. It became a movie. In fact, after Time to Kill, he had The Pelican Brief, The Rainmaker, The Firm that starred Tom Cruise when it was made into a movie. And so he wrote all those movies. But probably my best or my favorite book of his is called The Testament. If you've not read the book, I'm not going to totally destroy the storyline, but I'll just sort of give you a teaser. The story is of a rich billionaire who has 6 children by 3 wives, and shortly before his death, he has a handwritten will where he gives all of his money, not to the children, not to his ex-wives, but he gives all of his money to an illegitimate daughter named Rachel Lane. And Rachel basically had no relationship to him at all, but he gave all of his billions and billions of dollars to this young lady. She just so happened to be a missionary in South America, in the jungles of South America. And so after his death, there's a lawyer named Nate O'Reilly. Nate was a drug addict, a drunk. His life was out of control, and his job was to deliver the paperwork to Rachel to tell her that she is now one of the wealthiest women in the whole world. And so that's a long adventure of him getting down there. He finally finds Rachel. He presents her the papers and says, all you have to do is sign right here, and you become one of the most wealthy women in the whole world. And she looks him in the eye and says, Nate, I don't want the money. I don't want the money. It rocks Nate's world. How in the world could anybody, given the opportunity to become an instant billionaire, how could anybody living in the jungle in a hut not want to become one of the wealthiest people in the whole world? And she said, I don't want the money. By the time the story's over, Nate becomes a follower of Jesus. You see, the thing about Nate and the thing about John is that John Grisham is a Christian. He's actually a Baptist, believe it or not. And he went into writing to basically capture the essence of the gospel, to capture the essence of how God touches and changes lives. If you read his books, one of the things you'll discover is if you make a bad choice, if you do something you know you shouldn't do, guess what? Consequences. Bad things happen. The Bible says you reap what you sow, right? And so what John does is he takes the concepts and the theology that you find in the Bible, puts it in a story that people will read so that they go home and think about, why do we do what we do? Probably one of the greatest writers in the English language is probably William Shakespeare. If you've been through high school, you had to read William Shakespeare whether you wanted to or not. I was in a high school class, and we actually had to do the play Romeo and Juliet in class. You know, the teacher assigned us all parts, you know. You know, Romeo, Romeo, wherefore art thou, O Romeo? That wasn't my part because that's Juliet. But anyway, so we're sitting there waiting our way through Romeo and Juliet. And, of course, he wrote Julius Caesar, Henry IV. He wrote just countless, actually 38 plays. His vocabulary, based upon research, he had a vocabulary of 21,000 words. Now, let that sink in. 21,000 word vocabulary, plus he added to the English language 3,000 words. Okay, he had a vocabulary of 21,000. He added 3,000 words to the English language. I don't want to play him in Scrabble. I don't know about you. That's not somebody I want to play in Scrabble, because it's just not fair when you can make up words, right? I mean, you're sitting there and they're making words up like Robin does. And so anyway, we have to have a dictionary when we're there. Anyway, so William Shakespeare was a master of the English language, a master of telling stories. Listen to one of his quotes from Hamlet. Now, you'll probably remember from Hamlet, "To be or not to be." This is not that quote. Listen to this one. He says, "We know what we are, but we know not what we may be." We know what we are, he says, but we know not what we may be. Translation, there's still more to be written about your life. The final word has not been spoken yet. Now, let's imagine that your life was a novel, okay? If your life over the last 10, 15, 20, 40, 70, 80 years, if you look back over the storyline of your life, would you give the novelist a bonus, or would you fire him? You know, I mean, if you look at your story, did your story turn out the way you wanted it to? I hope the answer is yes. But the possibility is some of us would sadly say no. I'm not where I wanted to be. I'm not who I wanted to be. This isn't what I dreamed of. And yet you find yourself trapped in a story. Let me introduce you to another author. This author never did use pen or paper, but he's the greatest storyteller the world has ever known. His name is Jesus. You see, I believe that Jesus is an author. If he were a painter, he would take a canvas and he would paint a picture, and that picture, in essence, would capture a moment in time. But you see, Jesus is a storyteller. There's not one picture, there's not one moment in your life that defines reality. A storyteller can always flip another page, can always start another chapter. With a storyteller, he can keep moving the story along, and that's what Jesus does. You see, the last chapter of your story has not been written. This morning, I'm going to show you an example of where Jesus, as a master storyteller, as a master writer, changes a man's story in a wonderful and powerful way. If you have your Bibles, you will turn to the Gospel of Luke. We're going to begin in verse 27. Luke chapter 5, verse 27. I'm going to introduce you to a man by the name of Levi. Levi ends up being one of the disciples of Jesus. We often call him Matthew, but in this particular story, Luke wants to use the name Levi because I think it's important. Another key character in this particular story are two groups of critics of Jesus. The one are the scribes. The scribes were the biblical scholars of Jesus' day. They knew the Old Testament, particularly the first five books of the Old Testament, like the back of their hand. But the things about the scribes you need to remember is this. The scribes were very, very, very good with details and data, but they didn't understand the big picture. They didn't get the point. Their best friends were the Pharisees. The Pharisees, likewise, were incredibly religious men, but they got caught up in doing the details, and they likewise missed the big point or the big picture. And so Jesus is going to teach them a lesson today. Chapter 5, verse 27, it says, "After this, he went out and he saw a tax collector named Levi sitting at the tax booth, and he said to him, 'Follow me.'" Okay, we'll pause it there. Very first two words, "after this." One of the things you need to learn as you deal with Scripture, if you're going to move past the details and get to what it really is all about, is context. You've got to learn context. To make the Bible come alive, you have to put it in its context. Well, this particular verse will make more sense if you will understand about after this. So what happened before Jesus found Levi? Well, it's a great story. In the verses that lead up to verse 27, basically, Jesus at this point is incredibly popular. He's in Capernaum, which is essentially his adoptive hometown. Jesus grew up in Nazareth. He moved from Nazareth to Capernaum, which was a village on the Sea of Galilee, about 1,500 people, so it's a small town. And Jesus is basically teaching and preaching. And on this day, he's in a house having a home Bible study. But when word got out that Jesus was in the house teaching, everybody shows up. The house is absolutely, completely full of people. In fact, there are people standing around the house, peering into the windows and doors. And so there's no room for anybody else. Meanwhile, there's a group of guys who have a friend who's paralyzed. And they know that Jesus has the ability to heal. And so they've gone to their friend's house, loaded him up on a blanket or a mat, and they've hauled him down to where Jesus is. When they get there, they cannot get into the house. Okay, you get the picture. They cannot get in. There's no room and nobody will let them in. Now, Texas A&M did not exist at this time, but I believe that these men would have been Aggies, okay? Because they came up with what I'm going to call Aggie engineering, and they came up with a way to get this guy to Jesus. Now, here's the plan. They decide, when you loved a bit in the conversation, they decide we're going to climb up on the roof. We're going to tear a hole in the roof. Now, this isn't their house. This is a neighbor's house. We're going to tear a hole in the roof of our neighbor's house, and we're going to lower our friend down right in front of Jesus. Doesn't that sound like Aggies? Doesn't it? There's some Aggies out there. Give me a whoop or a thumb or something like that. Well, anyway, so they're up there, and so Jesus is sitting downstairs teaching, and, you know, they start hearing a commotion on the ceiling. You know, I don't know if Jesus was distracted, but I can imagine people are looking up like, what in the world's going on? About that time, they hear people tearing the roof off. Suddenly, there's a skylight that there hadn't been there before. And then suddenly, out of the skylight, dropping down below Jesus or in front of Jesus, is a paralyzed man. Now, this is what happened right before Jesus went to see Levi. When the man's lying in front of Jesus, Luke says Jesus looked up, and he saw the faith of those men. He could see in their eyes that they believed with all their hearts that Jesus had the ability to heal their friend, and they were not going to take no for an answer. They would do whatever it took to get their friend to Jesus, and so they did it. They tore a hole in the roof, and they dropped their friend right in front of Jesus, and when Jesus saw their faith, he looked at their friend, and he said, "Man, your sins are forgiven." Now, who writes this stuff? I mean, seriously, that's not what they wanted. They wanted Jesus to say, "Buddy, get up and get out of here." They wanted Jesus to heal their friend. And the very first thing that Jesus said was when he looked into the eyes of their friend, he said, "Your sins are forgiven." Now, before you think Jesus is crazy, remember that he's God. He knows you better than you know yourself. He knew that man better than the friends knew him. And he knew at that moment that what that man needed more than anything, more than the ability to walk, what that man needed more than anything is for his sin and his shame and his guilt to be forgiven. And he said, "Man, your sins are forgiven." Meanwhile, remember the scribes and the Pharisees? They nearly blew a gasket. They heard what Jesus they said, and immediately they went to all the details. And the details say that only God can forgive sin. And so you notice in the story what happens. It says that they began to grumble and talk among themselves. In verse 21, it says, the scribes and the Pharisees began to question, saying, "Who is this who blasphemes?" In other words, they're saying, only God can do that. Jesus has just said something that is offensive to God himself. He is saying things that should never be said. Who is this that blasphemes? And then, and here's where Jesus probably smiled, "Who can forgive sins but God alone?" You see, that was the point. On this particular day, Jesus was going to teach people about forgiveness. He was also going to teach them that he wasn't just an average rabbi, that he was the Son of God. And so when they said, "Who can forgive sins but God alone?" Jesus had them right where he wanted them. Because now the issue in front of everybody is only God can forgive sins. And Jesus just forgave this man. And so Jesus, in response to their question, it says in verse 22, he perceived their thoughts and he answered them, "Why do you question in your hearts? Which is easier to say, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Rise and walk?'" He said to the people that majored on the details, which is easier, for someone to say, "Your sins are forgiven," or to say to someone who's paralyzed, "Get up and walk"? Well, the thing is, they're both impossible for us. Only God can forgive sins, and only God could cause a paralyzed man to get up and walk. And so Jesus, knowing what was rattling around in their minds, he said, verse 24, "But that you may know that the Son of Man," which was his nickname, "that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins." He said to the man who was paralyzed, "I say to you, rise, pick up your bed, and go home." And the paralyzed man got up and went home, glorifying God. Joni Erickson Tada, when she was a teenager, she did what a lot of dumb teenagers did. She dove into some water that wasn't deep enough. She hit her head. She broke her neck. Her friends hauled her out, or she would have drowned, because after she broke her neck, she couldn't move her arms, she couldn't move her legs. She was absolutely, totally paralyzed. It would have been really easy for her when her whole world just crashed in around her. It would have been very easy for her to have been angry with God. But she turned to God. She called out to God. She had countless friends that prayed that she would be healed. People anointed her with oil. There were people that had visions of her healing. She never walked again. In fact, she's still alive today and has not walked. In her walk with Jesus, in her faith, she's discovered life as it was meant to be. On one occasion, she talked about faith healing, and she said, "You know, the problem is too many people focus on the physical, and they forget the fact that Jesus is more concerned about our soul. He's more concerned about our relationship with him." In fact, this is a quote from her. She says, "My weakness, that is my quadriplegia, is my greatest asset because it forces me into the arms of Christ every single morning when I get up." She said, "What most people would consider the curse of my life, what most people consider the worst thing that ever happened to me," she said, "it's not that, because my weakness, being paralyzed, my ability to move actually causes me every morning to throw myself into the arms of Christ and to know him in ways that I would have never known him if I was whole and healthy." You see, Jesus said to that man, "Your sins are forgiven. Your sins are forgiven. Your soul is whole." Well, as he was walking out healed and whole, Jesus just walked out right after him. And so you see this man sort of running down the street, having been healed, the crowd sitting there in stunned silence, and Jesus and his disciples walk out. And so Luke tells us that after this, after Jesus had healed this man, after Jesus had forgiven this man, it says in verse 27, he went out and he saw a tax collector. The word "saw" doesn't mean that he accidentally glanced over. It meant that he looked for him. He was looking for this man. He was looking for someone else that day that he would change the story of their life. And on this particular day, he saw a tax collector. Now, in your mental image, as you think of tax collectors, you think of an IRS agent, right? Have you ever gotten one of those letters from the IRS? You know, those are dreadful things. You know, what mistake did I make? I hope I'm not being audited. Can you picture in your mind an IRS agent sitting behind his or her desk, sitting there with a stack of papers and a red pencil? And you know, I mean, you just got all these images. Well, that's not the Roman tax collector, okay? A Roman tax collector was powerful, treacherous, greedy, rich, very, very rich, successful, at least in the world's eyes. Because you see, what a Roman tax collector did was they linked up with the Roman Empire, and this was the rules. You gather the taxes due to Caesar, and anything else you can get is yours. So if Caesar wanted 10% and you can get 20%, then you keep the 10 for yourself. Imagine going to an IRS agent and sitting down in the IRS agent with two armed SWAT soldiers or officers behind him, because that's the way they worked. The IRS agent says, well, you owe Rome $1,000, but just for good keeping, I think you need to pay $2,000. They're holding their machine guns. He said, you're not leaving till you pay me $2,000. What are you going to do? You're going to do what he says. That's the only way you get out. And so the tax collectors extorted money from people. They hated tax collectors. They wouldn't even let tax collectors go to church. You know, they would have had Joe Garte at the front if they saw a tax collector. He said, no, I'm sorry, you can't come here. You can't come to First Baptist Church. I mean, they wouldn't even let them in the building. They despised tax collectors because they were part of the Roman Empire that was holding them under their thumb. And it says that Jesus saw a tax collector, and his name was Levi. Now, what's with that? Why didn't he call him Matthew? Well, he could have called him Matthew. But the name Levi is a Jewish name that goes way, 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 way back, all the way back to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You see, Jacob had a bunch of boys. His third son was Levi. His third son was born to his first wife. Jacob had two wives. He had Leah and he had Rachel. He was forced to marry Leah. He loved Rachel. Leah got pregnant, had Levi. She named him Levi because it means to be joined to. This is what Rachel was thinking. If I can give Jacob a boy, maybe Jacob will fall in love with me. Okay? She was thinking, if I give my husband a son, then my husband will love me. And so when that little boy was born, they gave him the name Levi, which means to be joined together. But sadly, it didn't work. Levi's descendants, you can trace them all the way to the days of Moses. In the days of Moses, Levi's descendants were called the Levites. You ever heard that term, the Levites? If you're familiar with the Old Testament, you know that the priests and the Levites, they were the ones that were supposed to stand between God and the people. In some cases, some said the Levites were like God's royal guards. They were like his honor guard. The Levites were supposed to represent God. You get where the story has gotten twisted? Levi came from a family that was supposed to honor God. And Levi is a tax collector for Caesar. He's everything he wasn't supposed to be. Have you ever been in a spot where you wake up and you think, how in the world did I get here? This isn't how my life was supposed to turn out. I'm not supposed to be this kind of person. That's Levi. And so Jesus saw Levi, and notice, Levi was sitting at the tax booth. So when Jesus changes the story of Levi's life, Levi is not chasing after Jesus. Levi is sitting, trapped in the world of his own making. What I think Luke is trying to tell you is that Jesus knows where you are. He knows the mess you're in, and that Jesus comes looking for you. That Jesus was looking for Levi, and Levi was sitting at the tax booth. When Jesus sees him, he says to him, "Follow me. Follow me." This probably was not the first time that Levi had ever seen Jesus. There's a good chance Levi had actually gotten taxes from Jesus. It's a small town of 1,500 people. He probably stood in the back and listened to Jesus. Jesus had been calling disciples. He'd heard stories about people being invited to be part of Jesus' band. And Jesus comes where he is and he says, "Levi, I want you to follow me." Now, here's where the story changes. Levi could have stayed right where he was. He could have kept doing what he was doing. He could have continued to play out the story that he had written, or he could get up and follow Jesus. So what's he going to do? Is he going to stay in the prison of his own passions? Is he going to stay in the mess that he created? Or is he going to accept Jesus' invitation and get up and follow? Well, you probably read ahead. In verse 28, and leaving everything, he rose and followed him. When Levi had the chance to turn a page and to start a new chapter in his life, he took it. Did it cost him? Absolutely, it cost him. He left his career, he left his job, he left his money, he left all of those things. But he was glad to trade all that in for another page and another chapter and a new beginning. In fact, strangely enough, you see the word rose, it says that he rose. Luke used the exact same word to describe what happened to Levi as what happened to the man who was paralyzed and got up and walked. You see, when God changes a human heart, it's as big a miracle as anything you will ever witness. He rose and followed Jesus. Well, where did they go? Strangely enough, they didn't go to church. They didn't go to worship service. They had a party. Did you see what happens next? It says, and Levi made him a great feast. That's a translation of big party. They had a great feast. And in the house, in his house, there was a large company of tax collectors and others. Notice others is going to be important in a minute. Reclining at table with them. So this Levi throws this huge party because God, through Jesus, has given him another chance. Several years ago, I was in Brazil, and I was with a team, and we were going door to door talking to homeowners about their relationship with Jesus. And I remember a hot afternoon, we were sitting on the porch with a young mother. She was probably in her 20s. She had a couple of toddlers at her feet. And using a translator and sharing the gospel in Portuguese, we talked to her about Jesus and told her that she could give her life to Jesus and her whole life could be changed and she could be forgiven. And I'll never forget when we invited her, "Would you be willing to give your life to Jesus?" She nodded and said yes. And then we prayed with her and she accepted Christ as her Savior. When I looked up, you could see the tears running down the corner of her eyes, down her face. And then this big old smile came across her face. And she said to us in Portuguese, she says, "We need to celebrate. We need to have a party." She said, "Let's have ice cream together." It was a hot day in Brazil. We said, "Sure, let's have ice cream together." And while she went to the kitchen to get ice cream, I was reminded of Luke chapter 15. Remember in Luke chapter 15, Jesus tells two stories. He tells a story about the shepherd who lost the sheep and the woman that lost the coin. And at the end of the story, the woman that lost the coin, it says that when a sinner repents, listen to what Luke 15:10 says. It says, I've lost it here. How about I'll paraphrase? It says that there is rejoicing before the angels of God when one sinner repents. There's rejoicing before the angels of God. Now let's unpack that. It didn't say the angels of God were rejoicing. Another way of translating it is there was rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God. Who's rejoicing? God is. When one sinner repents, when one person gets up and says, I'm tired of the story and I want a new chapter in my life, when one person repents, God himself celebrates. So we enjoyed ice cream on that hot afternoon because one of God's children had given her heart to Jesus. Levi threw a party. It was quite a motley crew that showed up. A whole bunch of tax collectors were there. But then there were those others. Well, as the party is going on, those scribes and Pharisees, they show up. In verse 30, it says, and the Pharisees and the scribes grumbled at his disciples. In other words, they don't talk to Jesus. They're not going to talk to Jesus. They're afraid of Jesus. These guys are cowards. They go to Jesus' disciples, and this is what they said. Why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners? Did you hear it? Luke said that at the party were tax collectors and other people. When they looked at that crowd, they said, why are you hanging out with tax collectors and sinners? You see, when you get caught up in the details, you don't care about people. And when you get caught up in the details, you see everybody as lost causes. They're just a bunch of sinners. Why in the world are you hanging out with sinners? These are not the kind of people that God's people should hang out with. Well, Jesus hears the cowards. And so Jesus answers. In verse 31, he says, those who are well have no need of a physician, but those that are sick. Remember, the Pharisees and the scribes, they're all about the details. They miss the big point. Jesus said, guys, you don't get it. Those that are well, those that have it all together, those whose lives are what they want and dreamed it should be, they don't need a doctor. Sick people need a doctor. A few days ago, I was in Fort Worth. I had the privilege of, my son-in-law took his father-in-law to work day, okay? My son-in-law, Philip, who's a pediatrician, hospitalist, he took me to Cook's Children's Hospital and gave me the grand tour. I got to go places where only doctors get to go, you know, where they, you know, take naps and where they can look at all kinds. You know, they actually have a place to sleep in the hospital. I don't know if you knew that. That's why you're sitting and waiting. Just kidding. Well, anyway, so he took me through. If you've ever been to Cook's Children's Hospital, it's like a fairy tale land. If you go into the main building, it's actually designed like a fairy tale castle. And so when children go in there and they look up, it's just amazing. And then they have these game rooms that have every single conceivable video game you could imagine. There was one sports game room that Troy Aikman decked out. Who knows how much money he spent so sick children could sit there and play the finest and the best video games the world has ever seen. It was just an amazing, beautiful place. But you know, parents of sick children do not bring their children to Cook's Children's Hospital because it looks like a castle. They don't bring their children to Cook's Children's Hospital because they have the best video games in town. They bring their children, their sick children, to Cook's Hospital because it has some of the best doctors in the world. And they want their children to get well. Jesus said, guys, let's think about it. Why am I here? I'm here for people who are sick. Not just physically sick. Sick in their souls. I'm here for sick people. Why are you surprised that I'm hanging out with tax collectors and sinners? They're the ones that need to rewrite the story of their life. The sick need a doctor. And then he closes with this statement. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repent. Translation, I came so anyone and everyone who's messed up, anyone and everyone who's found themselves trapped in a story that they don't want to be in any longer, that we can turn a page and we can start a new chapter and the story can be changed. You see, the word repent means to change the way you think, to change the way you see the world, to change the way you see yourself, to change the way you see God. It means to radically change who you are from the inside out. Jesus said, I came here. Guys, you need to understand me. I came here because there are people who need to be forgiven. There are people who need a second chance. And I'm here to give them a chance to turn the page and to start a new chapter in their life. And guess what? When you turn that page, everything that was in the book before, all the bad and the ugly, you can write across those pages, forgiven. Forgiven. They no longer define who you will be. They no longer determine what your future will look like because all of those other pages have the big letters forgiven written over every one of them. And you can start new. Let's bow for prayer together. Lord Jesus, we thank you that somewhere in this room this morning, there's somebody, I believe, that's going to turn a new page and they're going to start a new chapter. You're going to write forgiven over everything that has happened to this point. And the first line of the next chapter is going to say free. Free to be who we were created to be. Free to be the person that you long for us to be. Free to pursue the dreams and aspirations you planted in our hearts. Free to follow you. Lord, if there's someone here this morning that wants a fresh start, I pray that they would hear your words whispering, the same words that you spoke to Levi, that they would hear you say, follow me. And that's exactly what they'll do. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. As we close our time together, Levi, as we talked about, probably felt trapped. He had made some choices and found himself in a place he didn't really want to be. And then suddenly Jesus stepped into his world and invited him to follow. That's my encouragement to you today. If you want to turn the page and start a new story, a new chapter in your life, trust Jesus. Receive his forgiveness and follow him. By following Jesus, you'll discover the life that you've always wanted to have and the life that you were created to be. Thanks for worshiping with us today. We hope to see you again next week.